Star Wars The Force Awakens was released almost 3 years ago. Some people loved it, some people hated it. Overall, the lasting influence seems to be positive. In any case, here are 7 things I like about Episode 7. Number 1. The relationship between Rey and Han. This was really sweet. Here we had a pair of an abandoned desert rat and an old mentor who had just decided he wanted to rebuild his family. They were exactly what was missing in each other's lives. She finally found a place she could belong. And he clearly was yearning for a scrappy youngster that could learn off of him, just like he had when he was younger. He actually goes a little out of his way to keep her around, and we've flat out never seen him explicitly tell someone that they have a place on the Falcon.
I've been thinking about bringing on some more crew, Ray, a second mate, someone to help out, someone that can keep up with Chewie and me, appreciates the Falcon.
Are you offering me a job?
Wouldn't be nice to you. Doesn't pay much.
You're offering me a job?
I'm thinking about it.
Kylo even accuses Han of trying to use Rey to replace him.
And Han Solo, you feel like he's the father you never had. He would have disappointed you.
Get out of my head.
While Han clearly is using Rey to fill a void, I don't think that makes their relationship any less real. Also, what is her formal relationship with Chewie?
Chewie kind of likes you.
With Han's passing, is she the new captain of the Falcon, or is Chewie? Is her formal designation Rey, employee to Chewbacca? I hope so. I think that's great.
Chewie, come on!
I need help with this giant hairy thing! Stop moving!
And number 2. No token cameos.
Penguin, Crazy Quilt, Eraser, Polka Dot Man, Mime, Tarantula, King Tut, Orca, Killer Moth,
March Harriet,
Zodiac Master,
Gentleman Ghost,
Clock King,
Calendar Man,
Kite Man,
Cat Man,
Zebra Man,
and the Condiment King.
Probably worth the Google.
The characters they bring back from the previous movies is sparing, and really, that's to the story's benefit. One of the biggest complaints about the prequel trilogy is that everyone already knows each other, that it cages the story.
And as a child, I built C-3PO. Huh?
And that just makes the galaxy feel smaller for it. Not here. We have the characters we need and few others. That makes sense. How many people stay in the same relationship for 40 years? Dynamics change. Plus, meeting more people just makes the galaxy feel bigger. Number 3. The destruction of Hosnian Prime. Now, don't misunderstand, I don't like this scene, and that's the point. It makes me uncomfortable to watch every time I watch it, for a lot of reasons I won't get into here, and that was the point. So as much as I don't want to admit it, it does what it's supposed to. I have to give them full credit. 4. Kylo fears the light. I thought this idea was really interesting. Kylo Ren is depicted as actually actively fearing the pull of the light side, and desperate to rid himself of its pull. Our previous villains simply were Darksiders. The idea that he wants to be evil, but isn't entirely, is not something Star Wars, I think, had ever really featured beforehand. Even Vader's transition back into Anakin was done with confidence. He knew who he was, and then he knew he was somebody else. Kylo isn't like that. He's determined to be a person he isn't. At least not yet. Even in the EU, Darksiders just were who they were. If they feared anything, they feared losing the light.
If I could return, oh my master, it has been so long, and I regret so much.
Number 5. The connection to the early Return of the Jedi draft. In 2010, producer Gary Kurtz, whose relationship with George Lucas had been described by Mark Hamill as mom and dad, revealed that the original idea for Return of the Jedi was a bit darker than what we got. Obviously, everyone already knew about the name change and the fact that the Ewoks were originally supposed to be Wookiees, but Kurtz went a bit beyond all that, revealing a few significant changes. The original draft, before Lucas changed it to include a euphoric happy ending, was much more bittersweet. The film would end with Han, having sacrificed himself, Leia burying herself in her work, and an emotionally drained Luke going off into the sunset. And tying into this totally makes sense. When the earliest production began in 2013, news of Kurtz's draft was still the freshest take on the original trilogy, not to mention Return of the Jedi was the least well-regarded of the three, so it makes sense that this early draft would be a huge source of inspiration, potentially. In Force Awakens, we find that Han had left Leia after the fall of their son, with Leia burying herself in her work. When Han returns, he goes to his death in an effort to save their son. And where do we find Luke? Emotionally drained, staring off to the horizon.
The fans argue about this all the time. Whether it would have been any better or not is impossible to tell because it wasn't made that way.
Number 6. The opening scene with Kylo Ren. Now, I liked this whole scene. I remember sitting in the theater watching it for the first time and thinking, yeah, they got this right. This feels like Star Wars. And a big part of it is how it sets up most of the characters we'll be following for the upcoming films and years. We meet and begin our relationships with Poe Dameron, BB-8, Kylo Ren, Phasma, and Finn. But the most interesting part, I thought, especially in hindsight, was the introduction of Kylo Ren. This was no Phantom Menace. This one swaggered onto the scene, declared his presence with a fresh brand of ruthlessness and new abilities. With hindsight, this scene is even better with age, because I think we also were introduced to another character, Ben, after viciously slaughtering our first POV character in the entire village. He realizes that one of his troopers is doubtful, insubordinate. He stares right at him, and then lets him go. Kylo Ren overlooks this without comment or word to anyone. Whereas later on, Finn was reprimanded by Phasma, apparently quite severely, for a lesser violation. Also, this leniency could also explain why he was so upset with Finn at the end of the movie.
Traitor!
This establishes our man in a mask as a greater authority, but lesser evil than the First Order. A stark contrast to Darth Vader, who was quickly established as a lesser authority, hanging shotgun to Tarkin, but a greater evil. Even without the added meaning apparent with hindsight, this scene sets up exactly how far Kylo Ren hasn't fallen, and just how far he has. Number 7. The Muffin. This is practical. This actually happened. Oh my god, there it goes! Honorable mentions. Maz Kanata's castle. This really feels like a place that Han would feel right at home. And then not.
Han Solo!
Oh boy. Hey, Maz.
Leia, when Kylo isn't brought up. General Leia comes across as extremely competent and would fit right into the mid-20th century. I can totally see her retaking the Philippines. She knows what she's doing, she's been doing it for decades, and she's here to get to work. Now, this list was not comprehensive, nor was it necessarily the seven things I liked the most. Just seven things that I liked that I could say a few things about other than... Yeah, I like that! That was really cool, that was really neat, yay, how was that? And no film is perfect. This one is certainly no exception. I think it has some serious flaws that I can have a hard time getting past. But overall, I like this film more than I dislike it. I'm perfectly content with it, but I'm not blown away.